You're the woman I love, and I love that you're gonna do me. I can't believe you really wanna still go through it. But the best part about it all is Bob Dole can't do it. He just say screw it. What? We're adopting a baby? But you're the woman I love, and I thought you were gonna do me. Adopting a baby. But you're the woman I love. You don't know what it's doing to me. Oh, I thought you were having a baby. Well, is there at least a chance, Rob, to get a nanny or one of them au pairs? I hope you're considering breastfeeding.
I want to grow up to be just like Jesus and never have to work. Just travel around from town to town, wherever evil lurks. Cross the Holy Land with rod in hand and sandals on my feet. But I'll stop a while and I'll share a smile with everyone I meet.
I miss in the morning.
Favorites. Been an attractive young man. Pat O'Brien. Good morning, Mr. O'Brien.
You know, I'm comfortable enough with my manhood to hear you say that again.
How's Linda and Sean?
Linda and Sean are fine, thank you. In fact, Sean and I were riding to school one day not long ago and heard you on KLGO, South San Diego. We turned it on. I said, hey, I'm on finally in Southern California. We turned it on. And I think you called me a moron. You ripped my hair.
Well, I don't know what
I said, Daddy, who's that? I said, it's a friend of mine.
Your radio sounds fun in the morning. You're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Good morning, Vic.
Hi, Imus.
Okay, tell me what Pat O'Brien looks like.
He's tall, wears glasses, well-dressed, double-breasted a lot.
How's his hair?
Thin on top.
You win the tickets.
All right, Imus. Hey, Vic, don't come 1 foot near me.
Imus in the Morning.
Touchy on it.
Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
If you're looking for a contemporary mid-size from Bill to Hillary.
Wanna have a new baby? What a lovely way of saying how much you love me. Wanna have a new baby? What a lovely way of saying you're thinking of me. Well, I can see it, that bundle you're holding. I can see my position in the polls, it's gonna be golden. Have a new baby. You're a woman in love and you're showing your true affection. Have a new baby. You're the woman who's gonna be sewing up my re-election. You screwed up health care. Your past is checkered. You almost blew it when you couldn't find them billing records. I'm a little hand-pickered. Now you're having a baby. You're the woman I love, and I love how you subdue me. Saying go, baby. You're the woman I love, and I love that you're gonna do me. I can't believe you really wanna still go through it. But the best part about it all is Bob Dole can't do it. He just say screw it. What? We're adopting a baby? But you're the woman I love, and I thought you were gonna do me. Adopting a baby. But you're the woman I love, you don't know what it's doing to me. Oh, I thought you were having a baby. Well, is there at least a chance, Rob, to get a nanny or one of them au pairs? I hope you're considering breastfeeding.
All right, let's go to line one, Lou, and talk to another goober, John from Hall River, North Carolina. Good morning, John.
Well, what do you say, Don?
How you doing, baby?
I'm doing great. You need to know something about your audience down here in North Carolina.
All right.
We're number 3 in the United States in trailer sales.
You are?
Yeah.
No way. You're kidding.
Number three.
Well,
half of your audience lives in a trailer.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
By the way, do you know what a North Carolina divorce and a tornado have in common?
No.
Somebody's going to lose a mobile home.
Imus in the Morning.
Yeah, I'm missing the morning. In your shorts, 2020 sports.
3 seconds, 2 seconds, 1. Colorado, how good can this feel? The Avalanche are going to play for the Stanley Cup.
An exciting night in Denver and a tough loss for the Red Wings. Good morning. Mike Ring with sports. Mike Haynes the call on KKFN in Denver. Colorado beating Detroit 4-1 to take the Western Conference final in 6 games. A disappointing finish for the Detroit team that set an NHL record with 62 regular season wins.
Well done, you know, you've got to get it done in the playoffs.
Yeah, that's right.
It's a different kind of hockey.
That's where it counts.
And, congratulations to Greg Bertuzzi, that geek.
Yeah.
And fat Bob Bartolomeo of Westwood Entertainment, who should both be fired by the Zen Master.
Right.
Because the station in Denver that we were on was sold, and a bunch of cheese balls bought it. They wanted to cut costs, and so they were paying an enormous amount of money for this program. It was, of course, worth it, but not in their estimation. So we are not on in Denver anymore. Although we are back on in Norfolk, and someplace else we're back on, right?
The Norfolk, Virginia Beach area.
And there's another place we're back on.
That's right.
Okay, but boy, I forget. Doesn't make any difference. Don't worry about it. But we should be on in Denver, and they certainly not being able to get it done. And we have some huge news that we will be announcing here shortly on the Imus in the Morning program involving both radio and television.
Whoa.
And I haven't decided who I'm going to leak the story to. I think I'll leak it to Hinckley or my man at the Washington Post, Jeffrey York, who I love.
You going back to VH1?
That is huge.
Some classics I know. So a tough way to end the season for the Red Wings. Imus in Washington, senior political analyst, the late Richard M. Nixon.
Happy days are here again. The skies above are clear again. Guess who's in deep doo-doo again? Happy days are here again. Well, it just doesn't get any better than this, right? Imus in the Morning. And if I may quote another dead guy who appears on this program, General Patton.
Yeah.
God, I love it so. So let's see what we've got, okay? As I interpret it, I do, it may be summed up in one simple phrase. Three down, two to go. Jeez, I really sound as though I'm exulting today, don't I?
Uh-huh.
Far be it for me to revel in the agony of others, though, especially when the trauma involves the President of the United States. Oh, excuse me, guy. That'll either be the champagne or the strip-o-gram lady Bob Dole was sending over. Yes, sir. Just set it down right over there. Nailed those goobers, didn't they? Got them by the shorts. And right when President Smug and President Miso-Virtuous were absolutely convinced that Jim Guy and the couple from Planet Amnesia, the McDougals, were going to walk.
Well.
But then, Little Rock, we have a problem. He shoots, he scores, and it's Ken Starr with a hat trick. Kind of puts the character issue right back out there, doesn't it, Donna?
Well,
when the president's former business partners and the guy who was his lieutenant governor and succeeded him in office are looking at a combined 111 years in the Charles Keating / Webb Hubble Memorial Attitude Correction Camp, eh? You know what this boils down to for the folks on Main Street, in my view?
No.
For over 2 years now, we've been hearing that people don't understand Whitewater.
Right.
Now, let me educate you, I do, about what people do understand. And that is what the word guilty means. And I'd wager they also understand what it means when your business partners are suddenly convicts. I'll just bet that Mr. and Mrs. Unsophisticated America can figure that one out about as well as, oh, say, Bob Bennett, who represents Captain Courageous there in the other little matter.
Well,
you know, the one where he invited Ms. Jones into his hotel room for a short-arm inspection and said to her, if I may paraphrase the commander-in-chief, blow, baby. It strikes me, J.D., that if they need more money for the Bill Clinton Defense Fund, and they will, they not only should release the testimony he entered, but they should sell it. Then we'd have two prominent national figures out there protesting their innocence on videotape, William Jefferson Clinton and Orenthal James Simpson. And now Hillary wants to get pregnant? Well, actually, I guess that's okay. I think they do have daycare at Allenwood. Ouch! Whoa, baby. an unfortunate and particularly harsh look into the Dick scope today,
yeah.
Sort of like when it was Dick Nixon who was the president of the United States.
All right, here's Rush Limbaugh with an unfortunate ode to our president, Bill Clinton.
And comes Mama, now is such a phony.
Feeding on the liberals whenever he thinks he can. Pat
you can in theaters today with I'm in on C-SPAN.
I like that very much. That's very good. Good morning, Mr. Buchanan.
Mr. Imus, how are you? That was just a terrific introduction.
Well, Brian Lamb, Mr. Buchanan, has this thing about this program. We don't know what it is. So I was asking one of the guys from C-SPAN, I said, don't you get complaints occasionally when we're on? He said, well, actually not that many, so maybe things are improving.
Well, maybe their audience isn't that big now.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Washington Bullets are having a Rename the Team contest. Team officials say the current nickname, the Bullets, suggests street violence and has nothing to do with basketball. Meanwhile, we're going to still go with the Washington Redskins.
Yeah. How about the Washington Crackpipes?
Imus in the Morning. Sports Radio 66 WFAN.
His campaign to regain political viability, here is the billionaire industrialist and grassroots reformer, H. Ross Perot.
Correction, Amos. I already got my viability back.
All right.
And you're the proof of the pudding. Congratulations on getting out of your recipe for disaster and getting with the program. How long have I been telling you that when you get down where the rubbers litter the road, or however that saying goes,
right,
that there wasn't a dime's worth of difference between Bill Clinton and Bob Dole? On the one hand, you got a dissembling, prevaricating hayseed with a vocabulary, Clinton. And on the other side, you got somebody who looks like they dug him off the side of a mountain in Peru where a bunch of pagans laid him out 500 years ago. No, sir, there's only one way to go, and I'm glad you finally figured it out.
Yeah.
H. Ross Perot, little man, big ideas, and he won't hump a mummy on you. Unlike our current commander-in-chief, ain't he? A Martian, maybe, but a dried-out old mummy? Never. But that does reveal something about Bill Clinton, don't it? Paula Corbin Jones and Jennifer Flowers is one thing, but a man who will hump a mummy will also hump you. It's just sad.
Yeah.
Makes you wonder what him and Hillary would adopt if they could, don't
they? Yeah.
What are they going to use for an adoption agency? A cemetery? A couple of very disturbed people, Amos. And here's another deal. How come every time I see Bill Clinton doing some military chore, you know, laying a wreath or this or that, he seems like he's walking through an Arthur Murray dance studio routine? He looks about as comfortable as Bob Packwood at a ladies' temperance meeting with his shorts full of mud daubers, don't he? If I drop my drawers to get the mud daubers out, I'm dead. And if I leave them in there with my willy, I'm dead. Real dilemma for the boy, Amos. Real dilemma. And especially when your political opponent, Bob Dole, is a true war hero. But what war? The Peloponnesian? He's older than fried water, Amos. Hell, it don't take a village. It takes a mortuary. And will somebody tell Bob Dole to stick in a preposition now and again? I mean, if he ever comes up with something to say. Because right now, he sounds like what you'd get if you crossed George Bush with a stroke. Can't make head or tails of it.
Well,
you know what I'm going to do with my presidency when I get in there, Amos?
No.
Privatize. Get the damn thing out of the fickle hands of the public. Run her like I run Perot Incorporated. Get under the hood, tear out a bunch of stuff like the AC and windshield washer and all that other extraneous junk, fire the travel office, and drop the big one on them snotty-ass friends. Never liked them years ago, don't like them now.
No.
That there's foreign policy, Amos. Anyway, you know what I'm talking about?
No.
Neither do I. Here's your soundbite. I'm using it for my revitalized bumper sticker, Amos. If you really want some serious change, vote for the runt who's seriously deranged. That'd be me, Amos. H-Rap Frank. Much obliged for having me on your show.
The little Martian who now has my support, at least, well, from the times until something else happens.
Oh, okay.
Until anything happens, frankly.
Well, there.
You're a registered nurse?
I'm a registered nurse. And I've been listening to all the problems that you're saying that you're having, and I might have one or two solutions for you. Well, first off, I want to let you know that I have visions of becoming the nurse of the stars, and you're my stepping stone to this.
Right. So you would come to my home and take care of me?
No problem.
I don't think so.
Why not?
I don't know.
You afraid of having my hands on you?
Well,
if your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
I don't think I want to be saying Nurse Kurt. Nurse Kurt, could you bring me another glass of juice? Got to add some more Snapple. Nurse Kurt, is it time to take another vitamin pill?
Nurse Kurt, why are you naked?
Imus in the Morning.
Donning a biohazard suit, veteran broadcast journalist Walter Cronkite prepares to probe Hillary Clinton and her recent ruminations on a certain high-profile radio program host. The noted columnist Ray Kerrison put it succinctly the other day, referring to First Lady Hillary Rodham Clinton's appearance on the Larry King live television program. In a word, unbelievable. Well, this old, tattered, shop-worn, turmoil-tested guru of gazetteers says Mr. Kerrison has hit the target dead center in the billing record.
What Ms. Clinton did, abetted by her bespectacled, suspendered, milksop interviewer, was nothing less than launch her re-election campaign for the co-presidency she lords over her sissified, dewy-eyed husband. After watching the hour-long mutual swoon between Mr. King and Ms. Clinton, I suspect she'll be altering her name yet again to mark the onset of her second 4 years in office, from Hillary to Hypocrisy Rodham Clinton. As Mr. Kerrison noted, it was so bad, so disingenuous, that at one point, Hillary Clinton, fixing her face in its most unctuous motherhood mode, fluttered her eyes straight into the camera and denied that she's a liberal. Correct, Mrs. Clinton. And I'm not a washed-up, news-fried, white-headed, wrinkle-racked, award-awash, beaten-down veteran of the network news wars. Who the hell do you think you're kidding? Yeah. Of course, she was unchallenged in any assertion she made, no matter how incredible, because she was appearing with Mr. King, the puff poof, which guaranteed at the outset that she would be free to say anything and explain nothing, thus carrying forward the basic tenet of the Clinton co-presidency. Through partial birth abortion, the two waited, and through Medicare and Medicaid, Travelgate, Whitewatergate, and on. Larry, gazing at his guest with rapture, this angelic defender of the downtrodden and disadvantaged. And he effused at one point how Miss Clinton had been so terribly vilified by her critics. As the First Lady dropped her gaze demurely, bathed by the putrid swill spewed by the pathetic emetic of TV talk. Worst moment for this old reporter, when Mr. King, gazing goo-goo-eyed at Ms. Clinton, asked whether there had been, quote, a lot of pain from Don Imus's remarks at the celebrated radio-television correspondence dinner. No, not really, not personally, she replied in her best cookie-baking, it takes a village tonal inflection, but I was stunned by what he said about other people. That did shock me. Yes, indeed, Miss Clinton. What the I-Man said about other people, the very same people who you suggested were so callous and zealous in their coverage of your co-presidency that they hounded Vince Foster and, more recently, Admiral Mike Fordham right into their graves. Seems to me Miss Clinton has learned her lessons well at the knee of her flapjack husband, whose own book will be entitled I Never Met a Side of an Issue I Didn't Like. But first, Miss Clinton, perhaps a sequel to the classic movie Three Faces of Eve. You star, and we'll call it The Two Faces of Hillary. For Media Watch, this is Walter Cronkite. Thank you and good night.
1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
Championship underway. Good morning. Mike Brand with sports. Stan right. Dyke with the call. Stan Dyke with the call on the LPGA Radio Network. U.S. Open from North Carolina. First round leader, a tie. Beth Daniel and Kimberly Williams, both firing a 1-under 69. Daniel says she has the lead now, but she knows well the rest of the field can certainly play.
I have a great deal of respect for them. They play the game the right way.
They'll tee off in just a short time to start round number two.
Hey, you're an idiot.
NBA playoffs, Jazz force a game seven. Last night in Utah, Jazz ripped the Sonics by 35 points. Seattle coach George Karl was asked to analyze the blowout.
You know, when one team plays good and the other team plays poorly, that's what happened.
There you go. Game seven. Sunday night in Seattle.
What happened to him? Did somebody hit him in the face with a snow shovel? Or what exactly happened there?
I'm not sure. Just okay. A little disfiguration. You should know something about that. NHL playoffs. Game seven will be played between Florida and Pittsburgh. And that's because the Panthers beat the Penguins last night 4-3 to tie that series at 3 games apiece. French Open tennis, no real upsets. Winners include the Imus of the Morning of the Tennis Tour, Tomas Muster, and the women's top seed, Steffi Graf. Muster, who is hated by all of his peers, winning in straight sets.
Hey, Bubba, I'm getting confused with all these Imus road trips. Where the hell are we now?
We're all in
North Carolina, Beavis. Just another stop on the I-Man affiliate affinity tour.
How come all these stations are in some goober redneck trailer park city?
Raleigh's not a goober redneck trailer park city, Beavis. It's the capital of North Carolina, which is...
a goober redneck trailer park state.
Now, Beavis, Raleigh is part of what's known as the Research Triangle. A lot of scientific discoveries have been made in this area.
Yeah, like how much moonshine you have to drink before you decide to marry your first cousin.
Raleigh was named for the English adventurer Sir Walter Raleigh.
Wasn't he that mo who invented cigarettes?
Well, he had something to do with the discovery of tobacco as a cash crop, but most notably, he was one of the first settlers here in North America.
Wasn't he also the dude who took off his pants and laid him across a mud puddle so some chick could cross the street?
Something like that. He was involved in the Lost Colony, a development in Roanoke, Virginia that mysteriously vanished without a trace. He was later executed for treason.
Let me get this straight. A dude who took his pants off for some chick and was involved in a shady development deal gets a city named after him?
Makes you wonder why there's no Bubba Town in North Carolina, doesn't it?
Don't worry. You'll still probably get executed for treason.
Shut up, you little twerp.
Help, I'm wild and I can't get down.
Sizable boulder has been kicked down the sides of Mount Hillary, soon, or so it would seem, to become a full-blown lookout below, save the women and children, screaming avalanche that will bury the 42nd and 42nd point five presidents of the United States, William Jefferson and Hillary Rodham Clinton.
Well,
yes, a crisis grows at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. The 42nd president is about to join the 37th in repeating those immortal words, and so I shall resign my presidency, effective as soon as the Allied band people can get here. How badly is Whitewater spinning out of control for the Clinton administration? Yeah. There is one absolutely irrefutable, unmistakable portent of pending doom, disaster, and catastrophe. Hillary is wearing pink. Yes, nothing misses the eye of this old print-battered, camera-shattered, torn and tattered news hound.
Yeah.
The other evening, on the very day the Little Rock jury slammed the McDougals and Jim Guy Tucker's heads together, yeah, Hillary Rodham Clinton appeared on Jim Lehrer's NewsHour in demure pink, recalling her earlier Pretty in Pink news conference, called to explain how the savvy little lady turned something like a laundry detergent coupon she clipped in the paper into a $100,000 profit at the Cattle Commodities Exchange. The pink outfit, ominous enough, to be sure. But this time, she topped it off with a Barbara Bush-style Republican pearl choker, leading this revered, adored, antique auditor of scandal-mongering hearsay to wonder whether the next location of a government standoff might not be the West Wing of the White House. The FBI and ATF versus Stephanopoulos, Harold Ickes, Mike McCurry, and the whole bunker mentality mendacious mob, because somebody's going down. Let's review how the disintegration began.
Okay.
First, there was the crack from the commander-in-chief that revealed heretofore unknown necrophilia tendencies. What he allowed is how he'd like to have a go baby moment with the 500-year-old mummified remains of an Incan teenager. Then, the bonehead brainstorm hatched to enable the president to duck the Paula Jones sex suit, employing much the same methodology that enabled him to duck the draft.
Well,
then, in a transparent attempt to deflect all of that negativity, there was the effort to float what I'm defining as the Sally Struthers strategy.
Yeah.
Ask not whether to adopt, or quick, Panetta, find us a kid. Well, nothing's working.
No.
For coming down the road like a train with a dead man at the throttle, the following. A second Whitewater trial, in which the president will be subpoenaed.
Uh-oh.
Grand juries probing the president's amnesic AIDS, the White House's lost and found billing records department, the D'Amato official findings report, and the prospect, at least, that Jim and Susan and Jim Guy could cut a deal to cut their sentences and send Whitewater coursing straight into the Oval Office. The bottom line, get a rope for the dope from hope. And that's the way it is. For Media Watch, this is Walter Cronkite. Thank you and good night.
All right, here now on the I Miss the Morning program, this one going out from Bill to Hillary.
Wanna have a new baby. What a lovely way of saying how much you love me. Wanna have a new baby. What a lovely way of saying you're thinking of me. Well, I can see it. That bundle you're holding. I can see my position in the polls. It's gonna be golden. Have a new
any patience, so make it quick.
Why don't you have any patience?
That's how you are. Yeah, can't tell you anything. You have no patience.
Well?
Had a mishap with the dog on the trip.
I don't want to hear about it. We don't want to hear about anything about bowel movements with the dog. Just eliminate that.
Well, no, it was just a slight mishap.
I don't even want to hear about it.
Your condom slipped off?
Your radio sounds funny, Marty. You're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Pulls over to go to the bathroom, you know?
Right.
No.
Come on.
I have the dog on the leash. I'm not paying any attention where he is.
Yeah.
And I'm looking down and I'm going on his head.
Imus in the Morning.
Continuing his mission to regain political viability, here is the billionaire industrialist, founder of United We Stand, H. Ross Perot.
Amos, hack up that leg for me for just a minute.
Why?
I want to take a look at that ball and chain. Just a little welcome back, happy new year, joyous marriage joke, Amos. She got you doing rope tricks? Because you look like Bob Packwood in a room full of blow-up dolls. Wore out. The way I see it, about 6 months down the road, you're going to be wishing that discount mattress outfit you're always advertising sold brand-name stretchers. Just a little age disparity joke. Don't go getting your underwear in a knot. Now, wait a minute. You don't wear undershorts, right?
Well, no.
That is sick. Nothing comes between you and your Calvins, or in this case, your Wranglers. I'll bet that ain't the first Wrangler you've ever had wrapped around those scrawny legs, but that's a whole other matter you probably don't want to go into here.
No.
Anyway, I know how these weddings can go sour on you when you're a high-profile person. You remember how George Bush tried to sabotage my world-class daughters?
Yeah.
Now, you didn't have any lesbians showing up on you out there in Utah, did you? No? Oh, that's right. Fred had a date, didn't he?
No, I was four-legged Fred.
Whatever. Now, I get criticized sometimes for being paranoid, Amos, just because I sicked a couple of detectives on my own children.
Yeah.
But I must say, I am very impressed with this new security system you put in right here.
What?
Cameras everywhere, keeping an eye on everything. I like it.
No, those aren't security cameras. This is C-SPAN.
I knew that. I'm a billionaire. C-SPAN, huh?
Yeah.
With that Brian Lame?
No, Lamb, Brian Lamb.
I'm sticking with Brian Lame, Amos. Have you caught any of those Lincoln-Douglas debate reenactments?
Good point.
Here's a memo to Bobby De Niro and Liam Neeson. Don't turn in your SAG cards just yet, boys. And I don't know how you feel about it, Amos, but the sooner that yellow bus goes off a 100-foot embankment, the better I'm going to like it. Or maybe slam his head on into John Madden's bus, and then, just for Mr. Lamb, gets creamed by a speeding bookmobile. I mean, I can't make up my mind which is more riveting. Some absolutely unknown congressman from Butt Flemish, Arkansas, reading an inane statement to an empty house chamber during special orders,
yeah.
Or Brian Lamb talking to some bow-tie-wearing egghead who's just written the definitive biography of Millard Fillmore's Treasury Secretary. It just can't suck any worse than that. Now to conclude here, Amos, the 104th Congress opens for business tomorrow, right?
Yeah.
Newt, Bill Graham, Jesse Helms and the boys. Weren't they those guys who tried to get Ned Beatty to squeal like a pig farm in Deliverance? I mean, believe me, there's your proof that Ross Perot doesn't hold the monopoly on sounding stump stupid, Amos.
No.
Anyway, the 104th in a nutshell, as Perot sees, were still held hostage. Nothing different happened on November 8th, and only the names have been changed to protect the guilty. And you can yank that off of your soundbite, Amos.
Yank this.
Angry? This river don't go to angry. You sure got a pretty mouth, ain't you? Take off them panties. And much obliged for having me on your show.
This is the Imus in the Morning program. It's 7 o'clock, WFAN New York.
That's terrific. Thanks, Mr. Mayor.
Leah Rabin, widow of assassinated Israeli Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin, says if Netanyahu does in fact win the election, that she just may pack her bags and leave the country.
Oh, come on, baby. Lighten up.
The state of Arkansas learns today, I... Come on, baby.
Okay.
Leah Rabin.
The widow Rabin.
Come on, baby, lighten up. Leah Rabin.
Well, you are an idiot.
You are an idiot.
Yeah, you are an idiot. Right.
Chill out, my son.
Oh, no,
come
couldn't.
On, chill, Mom.
If your radio sounds fun, Marty, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Here's what I don't need. She's my ear doctor, and I'm going to continue to go see her. But she looks in my ear, and she goes... Ew.
I don't think I need... Well, we don't need to even go on with this conversation.
No.
Good thing she's not your proctologist.
I'm in the Morning. Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
Hi, I'm Karen, and this is my...
Sports on WFAN, the flagship station for New York Mets baseball.
Sports Radio 66, the fan.
back for our final hour, final round here at Sports Radio 66 WFAN. Richard Neer till 10 o'clock. Dog will be here at 10. Got the Mets and Dodgers coming up in a late game this afternoon. 10 o'clock. The Dog is next. Thanks to Sam Rosen and thanks to Mike Hayes. We'll be back with you next weekend. Have a good one.
Sports Radio.
Occasionally, Bernard will call one of these morons who does one of these talk shows on this radio station, WFAN in New York, pretending to be, you know, one of the callers, like Antoine from the Bronx.
Antoine in the Bronx. Antoine, how are you?
Hey, yo, Joe Benigno, man. What's up, man?
What's up, baby?
Long time listener, man. Yo, turn the radio down on the air, man.
What's up,
yo? Do you know why I'm upset, man?
Why are you upset?
Yo, in a melting pot here, we call New York, we can't get a black coach. There's no black quarterbacks, no black pitchers, no black nothing, man. What's up with that? You got to get a brother in there for the big brothers, you know what I'm saying? Don't cut me off because I'm black, you know what I'm saying?
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
I hear you speaking on a lot of hockey issues, too, you know what I'm saying? I don't like hockey, you know what I'm saying?
Well, that's your broadcast.
You know, because in hockey, like the only thing black is the puck, and they be smacking that around.
Imus in the Morning.
WFAN New York, an Infinity Broadcasting Station. WFAN 2020 Sports.
Good morning at 10 o'clock. This is John Minko for New York Mets Baseball.
Sports Radio 66.
On a beautiful Saturday morning in New York. Nice to have you with us as we kick off a three-hour radio program for you today as we kick off the weekend. Nice to have you aboard. 718-937-6666 with Mike Hayes and Sweeney Murdy across the way. Lots going on today. We'll talk to Tommy Lasorda this first half hour or so. Get a little rundown on the Dodgers. Hopefully something on the NBA. We'll kill Albert.
From 5:30 until 10.
A new...
Sports Radio 66.
We got two game sevens. We'll get into that a little bit later on today with the game night in the hockey, game the ball in the hoops. Your baseball, Mets Dodgers at 4 on Fox. Let's see what Fox has made of right off the bat. They got a hot topic right now. You know, it's obvious that people saw this and are very down on Bell. It's a hot team, the Indians. It's one of the games they're doing today. It's a 1 o'clock start. Let's have Fox today in their pregame show. Don't give me a soft pregame. Let's have them. That's a now team. The Mets don't fit those categories. All right, coming back after we do the update at 12, so don't go away.
Sports Radio 66. The Fan. WFAN.
Are you ready? Joe Tolleson with 2020 Sports on WFAN. The flagship station of Imus in the Morning, weekdays from 5:30 till 10.
Sports Radio 66, WFAN, New York.
The right of the runner, a Herb score, Indian play-by-play guy. Wake up, will you please? Right of the runner? Oh, my fanny, the right of the runner. But what a bunch of homers those Indian people, I'll tell you right now. Unbelievable. You know, Hargrove, good, clean, legal play. I mean, give me a breath. How about somebody having the guts on that in that franchise to stand up to Bell and say enough of this? How about one person in that franchise, whether the owner, the general manager, the manager, a broadcaster, somebody have the right to have the guts to stand up and say, you know what, enough is enough on this player. Tonight, ESPN. Tomorrow at 7, Seattle and Utah. Mets at Fox, the Yankees on MSG, Mets on 9 tomorrow, Yankees on MSG tomorrow. Enjoy. Adios.
Sports Radio 66, the Fan, WFAN.
New York Mets baseball.
Sports Radio 66, the Fan.
A glory.
glorious Saturday afternoon from Shea Stadium. Good afternoon, everybody. 104 on the fan. Bill Daughtry at 718-937-6666. Taking right on up to Mets Extra this afternoon. 3:30 program with Ed Coleman as the Mets continue their weekend set with the Los Angeles Dodgers out here at Shea Stadium. Dodgers, of course, big winner last night, 10-3 on the homers by Piazza, Campos, and Mike Blowers. Bobby Jones, I mean, you know, he'll make a big deal out of it. The guy just went out and had a bad game after a...
First of all, here's the thing. I had a collapsed lung. And did I miss a day on the air, Charles?
No, you didn't.
So, damn it. So if you were a man... What? What? What is that all about?
Go right ahead.
Yeah, if you were a man, you would have come down here and faced off with Mrs. Anderson, but seems like a charming guy. Something you're not, Bernard.
You know, by the way, I don't know if Mr. Sodas knows, my two sisters both married black men. I don't mean Brian Dumble looking black. I mean some black man.
Fine.
Well, some black is years of spades, man. You know what I'm saying?
How does the But that doesn't make it legitimate for you to make these hideous racist remarks.
I don't make any hideous remarks.
I don't.
How about Maya Angelou and attack her? She's the racist. She doesn't see any white faces on Jeopardy. If I didn't see any white faces in the NBA and I said that, I'd be the racist. Attack her.
That's a good point. Well, now he's on
his soapbox.
It's a valid point. All right, please, Bernard, go take a nap, and we'll talk to you later. It's 22 minutes till the hour. Well, Larry, thank you very much for...
Barry.
That is wrong.
Oh, come on, man. By the way, my sister didn't marry any black men.
Barry Saunders here on the Ivins in the Morning program. Mr. Saunders writes for the News and Observer, and, you know, I really am... Here's the thing about you, Bernard. If you'd have been down and given that speech in Washington,
yeah,
and you'd have turned around and the president had been glaring at you, you'd have got down on your knees and gone, So you are. Both Charles and I have lost an enormous amount of respect for you.
Terrible.
For not being man enough to come down here to face the music.
I would have loved to have been down there.
Slap Mr. Saunders silly. You wouldn't have slapped anybody silly. He's about 6'4". You're not going to slap anybody silly.
That's all right.
So today, where the...
Imus in the Morning, 2020 Sports.
Russell gets off the three. Won't go. Game is over. The Sox are on their way to Chicago. Here they come with a 90-86 win over the Jazz in the seventh game of the Western Conference Finals. The Sonics, after a 17-year absence, are back in the bus, baby, and we're on our way to the Windy City.
A fairly exciting night in Seattle. Good morning, Mike Brayton with Sports, sponsored by Northwest Airlines. Kevin Calabro with the call. Game 7 last night, Sonics beat the Jazz to advance to the championship round with the Bulls. Jazz coach Jerry Sloan took the loss hard.
Well, it's just a basketball game.
Big game.
Well, that's good. That's a good point, yeah.
That's what it is.
So, I watched the Tony Awards last night because I didn't want to go downstairs, and neither did Mrs. Don Imus. So, Deirdre Coleman.
Yes,
that would appear in him, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would.
Monsters downstairs? What's the problem?
Yes.
So, yes, you're afraid of the monsters downstairs. So. But I was able seemed to suggest in his column that he wanted to get it on with Bernard. Well, I showed the column to Bernard yesterday, and suddenly Bernard developed this earache.
That's a lie.
Because Mr. Saunders, his photograph in the paper, he looks like a formidable person.
He looks like RuPaul.
He does not look like RuPaul.
He does not. You should see him.
You just shut up.
How big is he?
He's a big guy. He's about 6'4".
My brother.
What's up? If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
Hey, Bernard, I bought you a box of fried monkey carcasses, too, so I'm waiting for you to come and get them.
You want more liquor with that, brother?
Yeah, man.
You know what I'm saying? Be a big old 40 out.
You know, see here?
Yeah, I got your 40.
Imus in the Morning. Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
Beneath the bus...
Morning,
all right, here now with a special political commentary, the senior senator from the state of Massachusetts,
The Honorable Edward M. Kennedy.
What time is she meeting me? Kathy Hilton? No, Marriott. Fine. Tell her that I'm... my fellow Bay Staters and my fellow Americans, I reserve this time with you this morning to express the sense of indignation I feel, and I hope you share, over what can only be described as the continued pummeling of our nation's leader, President Bill Clinton. Enough is enough. The latest injustice evolved from Mr. Clinton's recent formal news conference, during which he was insolently asked whether he was still relevant in view of, nearly everything that's happened since he assumed his high office. I stand before you today to declare unequivocally, yes, he is. Furthermore, he is still relevant despite the rude rambling of the New York Times, which seized editorially on the anemic tone of Mr. Clinton's press conference performance with its tired laundry list of Democratic perennials, from which the rest of the nation has moved on. And despite the callous commentary of Jeff Greenfield, who reviewed Mr. Clinton's performance under the headline, The Shrinking President. I see from your photograph that you're certainly not shrinking, Mr. Greenfield. And despite the many other suggestions that Mr. Clinton's indecisiveness, his please like me psychosis, and his Dennis Fong malleability have laid our country open to anybody who gets their jolly seeing a former superpower squirm. Well, let's take just a moment to review why, indeed, our president is still relevant. All right, he's still young. That's very relevant. He went jogging with Uta Pippig, who just won the very relevant Boston Marathon. He has all his hair, and he digs chicks, for which I am personally quite thankful, as it gives me this sense of vindication somehow. So I say, for these reasons and many more, let the word go forth from this time and place that Ted Kennedy says enough bill bashing, enough of the sort of gratuitous item in the Washington Post. Reggie... let me find another word.
Yeah.
Dragging up mean-spirited white questions again. Reporting the fact that the white prosecutor is looking into whether a box of secret documents was spirited out of Vincent Foster's office the day after he Sam Cooked himself.
What are you saying? You're mumbling.
I know.
Well, what, are you drinking?
Not yet, no. I'm saying white...
Yeah.
Because if I say the rest of the word, which describes the chemical substance that covers three-quarters of the earth... You'd play that sound effect, recalling an unfortunate episode in my past that causes me to appear the fool.
Well, no, I wouldn't. First of all, that's childish, and second of all, we're past that.
Really?
You can say anything you want.
Anything?
Yes.
White water.
Senator?
Yes.
Is there anything else you'd like to say?
Just one thing. Told.
Here now, the President of the United States, Bill Clinton, as Bob Alanis Morissette.
I'm slick but bucolic. I'm young but I'm wise. I'm a relevant president. Yeah. I'm homespun yet handsome. Better looking than JFK. Chicks love when I say go. Mine.
sure do dread it, cause I know just what I'm gonna do.
Well, I gotta get drunk, Lord, I can't stay sober. There's a lot of good people in town. They love to hear me holler, see me spend my dollars. I wouldn't think of letting them down. Well, there's a lot of good doctors keep telling me, George, you better start slowing it down.
But there's more old drunks than they are old doctors, so I guess we better have another round.
Richard M. Nixon.
Happy days are here again. The skies above are clear again. Guess who's in deep doo-doo again? Happy days are here again. Well, it just doesn't get any better than this, right? Imus in the morning. And if I may quote another dead guy who appears on this program, General Patton, yeah. God, I love it so. So let's see what we've got, okay? As I interpret it, I do, it may be summed up in one simple phrase. Three down, two to go. Jeez, I really sound as though I'm exulting today, don't I?
Oh, no.
Far be it for me to revel in the agony of others, though, especially when the trauma involves the President of the United States. Oh, excuse me, I. That'll either be the champagne or the stripogram lady Bob Dole is sending over. Yes, sir, just set it down right over there. Thank you. Nailed those goobers, didn't they? Got them by the shorts. And right when President Smug and President Miso Virtuous were absolutely convinced that Jim Guy and the couple from Planet Amnesia, the McDougals, were going to walk.
Well.
But then... Little Rock, we have a problem. He shoots, he scores, and it's Ken Starr with a hat trick. Kind of puts the character issue right back out there, doesn't it, Donna?
Well.
When the president's former business partners and the guy who was his lieutenant governor and succeeded him in office are looking at a combined 111 years in the Charles Keating / Webb Hubble Memorial Attitude Correction Camp, eh? You know what this boils down to for the folks on Main Street, in my view?
No.
For over 2 years now, we've been hearing that people don't understand whitewater.
Right.
Now let me educate you, I do, about what people do understand.
Right.
And that is what the word guilty means. And I'd wager they also understand what it means when your business partners are suddenly convicts. I'll just bet that Mr. and Mrs. Unsophisticated America can figure that one out about as well as, oh, say, Bob Bennett, who represents Captain Courageous there in the other little matter.
Well,
you know, the one where he invited Ms. Jones into his hotel room for a short-arm inspection?
Fine.
And said to her, if I may paraphrase the commander-in-chief, blow, baby. It strikes me, J.D., that if they need more money for the Bill Clinton Defense Fund, and they will, they not only should release the testimony he uttered, but they should sell it. Then we'd have two prominent national figures out there protesting their innocence on videotape.
Right.
William Jefferson Clinton and Orenthal James Simpson. And now Hillary wants to get pregnant?
Uh-huh.
Well, actually, I guess that's okay. I think they do have daycare at Allenwood. Ouch! Whoa, baby! An unfortunate and particularly harsh look into the Dixcope today,
yeah.
Sort of like when it was Dick Nixon, who was the President of the United States.
2 minutes till the hour here now.
From ABC News, and this week with David Brinkley, Cokie Roberts. Good morning, Miss Roberts.
I must admit that I forgot we had this date this morning, so I'm just barely awake. I have to tell you this. This town went a little crazy with all of this sex stuff with the Hillary Clinton business. I mean, my reaction to this, I have to tell you, was if you can't take the heat, go back to the kitchen.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
It looked to me, being a runner, it looked to me...
You're a runner?
Yeah.
See, this proves my point about running.
Why?
Well, I mean... You know, you're fun to listen to, but look at you.
What do you mean, look at me?
I have yet to meet a runner who really looks great.
I miss in the morning. Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
And Transportation Department Secretary Federico Pena says he is standing by Value Jet. He says this report that showed Value Jet...
Not getting on it, but standing by.
Standing
right
by. Right there by the fuselage.
Yeah.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the Morning.
The tears-inspiring story, though, from Colorado Congresswoman Pat Schroeder in today's Washington Post, in which she recalls an episode when she shed tears. Schroeder says times have changed... But, guys, we want equal rights. Let us cry, too. That's the quote from
Ms. Schroeder. Oh, God, please shut up.
Yeah,
just get out.
Tree-hugging thing-bad.
Shut up. I bet tree-hugging thing-bad is a little tough.
A little tough, don't you, Bernie?
No.
So he cried when she couldn't get Katie Lang tickets.
That would be...
Highway Patrol.
Hi, am I, Mr. Morning? It is 20 minutes past the hour. Our traffic reporter, Eileen Marchese-Cohen.
In the morning, 2020 sports. Let's go to the audio tape.
Rollers are set now to pitch. That is a line drive caught by McGriff. Double play. The game is over.
Mets lose to the Braves in Atlanta. Good morning. Mike Green with sports. Bob Murphy, the call. WFAN in New York. Mets were leading the great John Smoltz and the Braves 4-1. The Braves stormed back, and manager Dallas Green didn't sound so good afterward.
We thought we could compete. You know, I thought Izzy was on his game, and we scored the extra runs. I thought it was, you know, I thought we had a good chance to beat him. We chased him out of there. We didn't take advantage of the rest of their bullpen. Their bullpen made the pitches. Ours didn't.
Well, you need some rest.
That was awful.
Well, they didn't win.
Man,
no, who cares about wins and losses? This man doesn't sound good. Other games, St. Louis playing San Diego 3-0.
That's like crickets.
A frog in a straw. Of course, he's not doing sports on the I'm a Sonian program, either, is he?
What does that mean?
Well, let's get with it here.
Lashing out already, are you?
Yes, I am. St. Louis playing San Diego 3-0. Manager Tony La Russa says they've had some great pitching.
You cut out one sluggish period, and our pitching has been good. Just that sluggish period.
You cut out about 60 losses, and you'd be in first place.
Well,
you know, a stupid way to look at it.
They've got to press on here. That's where things will get better.
Yes, all right. Yeah. Cincinnati lost at home to San Francisco 6-3. Milwaukee lost to Texas 9-6, but our Minnesota Twins beat California 9-3.
Well, it's soon to be our California. Probably it is now. It is now our California Angels, right?
Oh, okay. Yeah. So, yeah.
Wow. Too sure. Bad for our... Washington Network Newsroom.
I'm David Brinkley, host and principal commentator of our little effort here, joined as always by our regulars, Walter Cronkite, Rush Limbaugh, John Donald Imus, Paul Harvey, and Cokie Roberts.
No, no.
What?
She's not.
How's that? She yeah. Says that basically we suck.
Right.
Oh, well, okie dokie, no Cokie. Here now, the news. And first to Senate Majority Leader Bob Dole's speech in Detroit of yesterday, in which his challenge to President Clinton to balance the federal budget lost impact, observers said, because the senator, in his effort to assume a more casual and relaxed demeanor, appeared before his audience not only tieless, but also shirtless and pantless, wearing only his underwear. Here's some of what the senator had to say in his remarks.
Nothing to hide, jockeys or boxers. Bob Dole wants the people to have a clear understanding. Got to balance that budget. Got to move that ball. Question's how? Not hard to figure. Shut down some entitlements. Who's entitled anything anyway? No free lunch. Had to get out of the Senate. Bob Dole was getting beaten half to death by Chris Dodd, Bonner, that bunch. Been wounded once. That was enough. Federal budget, balance it. Got to ride that horse. Time's running out for the budget and for Bob Dole. Can't mask it. I'm looking at the casket. Tell you what, if anybody sees an issue out there, send Bob Dole a box, okay? Thank you. Thank you very much, Des Moines.
No, it's Detroit, Senator.
Yeah, well, whatever. Meantime, the man Senator Dole is challenging President Bill Clinton continued steering toward the political right, adopting more traditional GOP positions on a variety of issues. The president spoke to the matter in a briefing a short time ago for White House reporters.
Hey, baby, wanna go out?
Wait right there, honey. Gotta be willing to go with the political realities, you know. Bend a little here. See the practical aspects of the other side. Be big enough to acknowledge when they've got a good idea. Something helpful. I can do that. I don't think there's anything inherently wrong with that. No. So I've asked y'all to come here this morning so that I can announce to you, Clinton Gore's opening its first campaign headquarters in a rush room. 2:00 this afternoon, Jordan, Montana. Y'all are invited. See you out there. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Come here, Daddy. You look so good.
Listen, baby, I want you to dress up like that mummy, all right?
Mama, you're a liberal pedophile. How the Senate wouldn't get behind your health care plan. You got egg on your face. A big disgrace, but you can't resuscitate a terminal case. EIB will mock you. Mama, you're a Romeo You can't erase till Hillary puts your little Willie into his place. She will rock you. Give up the race. Bob Dole's gonna kick your butt all over the place. GOP will shock you. GOP will shock you.
Cigarettes.
GOP will shock you.
Everybody.
GOP will shock you.
I see a little silhouette of a man.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
Thunderbolt and lightning, very, very frightening
thing. Galileo,
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 Galileo, Figaro,
Galileo, Figaro. I'm too poor boy, nobody loves me.
He's just a poor boy from a poor family, sparing his life from this monstrosity.
I'm a
You guys spent 45 seconds. I guarantee you that if someone called in now, they wouldn't know what you're just talking about.
It doesn't make any difference.
And when the Democrats
why I'm one of the most powerful people in this country, absolutely. Because I don't care what people want to listen to.
Is this getting ugly?
Well,
it doesn't have to be ugly. I'm asking.
No, you've made it ugly.
It ugly by discussing something that... You were discussing.
Grow hair.
Oh, that's really cool.
It would have been the most powerful.
That is... Oh, you are 5 years old.
If your radio light sucks in the morning, you're listening to Ibis in the Morning.
This photograph comes from 1976.
Yeah.
And you know what drew me to this picture?
No.
What? Were these fresh tire tracks.
Mm-hmm.
But there was no evidence of anybody being there.
One of those
crop circles.
Get the
Ouija
board out. Eerie. And you looked at this and said, I think I'm out of blow, right?
And I
said,
Ibis in the Morning.
Perhaps should explain it's a snow scene.
Sports Radio 66, WFAN.
Lou didn't think of that when he made the... All right, let's take a minute to talk about of 96.
My friends, as I look out over this formidable assemblage of nascent burgeoning minds, I am greeted by a sea of faces filled not with eager anticipation, but rather paralyzing fear. I imagine that the relief you all feel after finally completing the requirements necessary for your various degrees must be superseded by the tightness of your collective sphincters. As you recognize, you are now about to be thrust into the pit of despair, affectionately referred to as life. Many of you realize you will now achieve positions of power and influence, despite the fact that you are about as prepared to take on their concurrent responsibilities as the average value jet pilot is to take on a water landing. I'd offer you advice from the Desiderata, the time-honored inspirational poem often quoted at times like these. Yet I think your interests would be better served by suggesting that you pattern your life after a role model. And what better standards bearer than the President of the United States? Therefore, I will recite from the Babadarata instead. Go placidly amidst the accusations and allegations, and remember what peace there may be in denial. Speak your truth sparingly and cagily, and listen to others. For even the dull and ignorant may later be used as an alibi. Avoid loud and aggressive persons, especially radio talk show hosts. Keep interested in your own career. You may not have it that much longer. Exercise caution in your business affairs, for the world is full of shady real estate deals that will surely come back to haunt you. But let this not blind you to what virtue there is. Many persons strive for high ideals. Just accept the fact that you're not one of them. Be yourself. Especially, do not feign affection, because later on, she'll just wind up suing you for sexual harassment. Never be cynical about love. Every once in a while, it can still get you to second base. Nurture strength of spirit to shield you in sudden misfortune, or at least learn how to place the blame on your wife. Be steadfast in your conviction, for an acquittal may be a long shot. Therefore, be at
peace with God, whatever you conceive him to be, and realize that in a world filled with all its sham, drudgery, and broken dreams, you fit right in.
This is an example of what is wrong with American politics. We set up things, we scream at each other, and you're a phony, and you're dishonest, and you misrepresented yourself. Now look, I'm trying to answer your question, and I will if you will shut up. Tell your mama, tell your pa, gonna tell you my now. I'm just so now. Mama, you don't do right.
I miss you in the morning.
Go, baby. They don't try to put me down.
Talking about those generations.
But I don't need a walker to get around.
Talking about those generations.
One thing's for sure, if they should whoop whoop.
Talking about those generations.
He could easily die before he gets in.
March Madness.
And college football here on CBS.
You
nice dope business.
You ball-headed skunk.
That is a home number you have for me, and don't you yell at me. I call your number, and
No. That's not a home number, because when I called it, somebody answered and said Pat O'Brien's office.
That's because Jaxie works at my office in my home. How did you get me? It's 6 a.m. In Southern California.
Is there an 05 in that number that you called, Bernard?
Yes, there is.
Oh, there are 205s in it.
Come on.
If your radio light sucks in the morning, you're listening to I Miss in the Morning.
So congratulations on L.A.
Oh, yeah, thanks, man.
Well, what's interesting is that with Timothy Leary gone,
you'll
be the second drug addict to die here in
L.A. I Miss in the Morning. Sports Radio 66, WFAU.
This is it, the last radio. Miss in the Morning, 2020 Sports.
Takes game one of the Stanley Cup Finals. Good morning, Mike Braden with Sports.
You know, I tried to find that last one. I couldn't find what was it broadcast on.
Fox.
No, that's one.
There you go.
I was looking at ESPN.
Yeah.
Idiot.
Couldn't find it. Sure. Mike Haynes to it.
Mike Haynes the call on KKFN in Denver. Couldn't happen to anyone. I'm in.
Sure.
The Avalanche beat the Florida Panthers 3-1. Colorado coach Mark Crawford was asked for the significance of the victory.
Well, it's always important to get a win.
Game two will be tomorrow night back in Colorado. It's going to be a great, great series. NBA Finals begin tonight. Bulls and Sonics for the championship. And because the Knicks are out of the playoffs, we've secured some Knick players for some analysis on these finals. This hour, we asked Charlie Ward if the Sonics can beat the mighty Bulls.
You never know.
More analysis from Knick players coming up throughout the morning.
You don't.
This is the morning program.
Yeah.
baseball. St. Louis Cardinals win again. That's
sure do dread it, cause I know just what I'm gonna do. Start spending my money, call everybody honey, and wind up singing the blues. I spend my whole paycheck on some old wreck, and brother, I could name you a few. Well, I gotta get drunk, and I sure do dread it, cause I know just what I'm gonna do.
Well, I gotta get drunk, Lord, I can't stay sober. There's a lot of good people in town.
They are old doctors, so I guess we better have another round.
I'm a in the morning.
Political announcement.
Hello, this is Ted Kennedy, senior United States Senator from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, scion of the Kennedy dynasty, influential figurehead of the most liberal extremes of our Democratic political party, and vigorous supporter of my junior Bay State partner, Senator John Kerry, in his defense of his Senate seat against challenger William Weld. Until now. It is with heavy heart I appear before you today to announce that while I certainly cannot support Governor Weld's bid for Massachusetts' junior Senate seat, neither can I any longer support the candidacy of Senator Kerry. Now, I know many of you are deeply disappointed. So am I. Why am I withdrawing my support of John? Have we suddenly differed on the great social issues confronting our nation? No. Have we all of a sudden differed on who has the greater family wealth? No. For as anyone knows, it is I. No, the reason I can no longer lend the Kennedy name to the Kerry cause is because of the shameless, sappy, immodest, insipid profile he submitted to by the repertorial dilettantes of People magazine that gushes revoltingly about the union of John and condiment queen Theresa Hines, that saw the senator's net worth ascend, with the words I do, from $100,000 to $760 million. Yes, I would have said I do also, and anything else Ms. Hines suggested. I will, I shall. I am an opportunistic parasite. I wear women's lingerie, anything.
Shut up.
However, I can no longer support or take seriously a candidate for public office who would allow himself to be photographed on rollerblades doing some sort of Bay Fandango with his wife for a publication that is little more than a supermarket UFO abduction scandal rag with shiny pages and whose profile suggests John used his war record as a babe magnet. Note the photograph of the dashing senator togged out in a leather flight jacket making goo-goo dollar sign eyes at Miss Hines. That gaze seems to say, in my view, Terry, you have such lovely credit cards. And I wonder about the many military patches that bedeck John's jacket. Will Newsweek be investigating any of those? Let's just hope that they're all, okay. And so, in conclusion, as I withdraw my support from John Kerry, I say let the word go forth from this time and place, and let this rhetorical question be posed. How can anyone cast their vote for a public figure who permits the following quote to be attributed to him regarding his wife? I was stumbling along until I met Terry. Now we both love the moonrise, the sunrise, the wind, and the water. Well, gag me with the gushing, over-sentimentality tongue depressor. No, the voters of my state would best be served, in my judgment, if the next time John and Governor Weld meet in debate, they both pass out. Thank you. Did I say water a few moments ago?
Yeah.
Surely not. I'm not that stupid on this program.
The preceding was a paid political indictment sponsored by Floatable Notables Advertising Incorporated. Ted Kennedy, Wilbur Mills, Gary Hart, Bill Colby, co-treasurers. Good morning, Governor Weld.
Hi, man. How are you?
I'm fine. How are you?
Good.
The Boston Herald the other day, I was talking to Senator Kerry earlier about this.
I heard. I was listening. You stick with Kerry, I man. Things are going just great.
If your radio sounds funny in the morning, you're listening to Imus in the morning.
Do you think it's appropriate to drag the First Lady in front of a federal grand jury?
You have to laugh about the records. That's a great story, showing up on the table.
The dog ate my homework, deal.
Well, I can understand how it would happen, though. The same thing happened to me a couple of years ago. A pair of tennis socks I was looking for. I was looking, and then suddenly there they were right under my feet, the tennis socks. So it can happen.
Were they under subpoena, those socks?
No.
Well, wasn't any blood on the socks, was there, Governor?
No blood on the socks. You know, it could have been a new cleaning service.